In fact, it had been stolen 3 times. A couple of months ago, we finished the 6th installment of Car Trek, and over the last couple of years, getting to shoot 6 of these series has been absolutely as much fun as I've ever had doing anything that could ever be called work. And so I cannot thank you guys enough for watching, and certainly Auto Tempest, and in this case, the Ticket Clinic, for co-sponsoring the series and making it possible. And the idea for Car Trek 6 sort of came about from a couple of factors. First of all, we wanted to have multiple cars for each of us to sort of reveal throughout the series. Also, Auto Tempest had mentioned, kind of anecdotally, that the 3 most searched for cars on their platform are a Porsche 911, a Toyota Supra, and a Ford Mustang. And we didn't necessarily want to make just a series on only those cars, but we wanted to build them into the plot line. And so the idea of the perfect 3-car dream garage with a total budget of $30,000 became the Car Trek 6 premise. And each of us was going to represent a different country. So we had to buy 3 cars from a certain country that included a sports car, a family sedan, and an off-roading SUV. Tyler immediately wanted the US, Freddie immediately wanted Japan, and I was kind of on the fence. I knew that I couldn't really buy an Italian SUV that would have made it make sense, and even then, trying to find a cheap Italian sports car was never gonna work out very well. There were some great UK options. I do love a Range Rover, but at the end of the day, Germany made the most sense. And for a budget European car, German cars tend to be the go-to. So I was gonna represent Germany, and I was going to begin with a Porsche 911. So I called everybody I knew, including Doug Tabbitt, the Mexican Stig of Switch Cars, and I said, hey, keep your eye out for a really terrible, probably 996, maybe an automatic convertible 997, you know, whatever it takes to get to the lowest possible allocation of my total $30,000 budget, let's try to find that. And in the meantime, Freddie had already sort of decided that his Supra was going to be the representative of Japan, even though obviously you couldn't buy a Mark IV Turbo Supra for that kind of money, and he's got, I don't know, $75,000, $80,000 in his, but he did buy it for $23,000 at one point. And Tyler was out to find a Mustang, which didn't work at all. He found a WS6 Trans Am. But over about, I don't know, a month or so of shopping, Doug did finally get the right car, but he didn't really find it. To be honest, he'd found it about 2 years prior. It's a 1999 Porsche 996 Coupe. It's a manual transmission car, limited slip differential, factory X51 power kit, and some awesome stuff done afterward. It had the hollow spoke 996.1 GT3 wheels. It had the TechQuipment roll bar without the crossbar diagonally to keep children from sitting in the back. This is the one that Porsche got sued over because young children were riding in the back with a roll cage around them effectively. Accidents were happening and they were dying. And so this was the roll cage that Porsche used to kill children. And so it was no longer available through the Porsche accessory catalog, but this car had it. It was a guards red car with a black interior, and it only had 47 or 48,000 miles on it. So it was a really, really interesting car, made much more interesting, of course, by its story. And as much as people can enjoy a perfect Concours version of a car, I always want the car with the story. And if I was going out buying this car as something perfect today, honestly, in this market, it's probably a $30,000 to $40,000 car. Now, that may be preposterous by any other language, but this car was not that. In fact, it had been stolen 3 times. It had a clean title, clean Carfax, but it was the dirtiest car you've ever seen. All of the paint was oxidized, and it was cracking and crumbling away. It had a lot of damage, some dents in the hood, some big gouges out of the rocker panels. There was a giant hole in the front bumper that had exposed the emergency trunk release. Everything was obviously cracked, faded, chipped. I mean, it was in awful, awful cosmetic condition. And Doug had known the car for a few years because it belonged to a friend of his. The friend had sort of taken the car over for its original owner, who was his father. And his father was an attorney that had worked for the Penske Motor Group and helped them to do land deals to buy dealerships. And part of his compensation in 1998 was that, in addition to being paid some money, he was going to be given the fastest 911 you could buy. Which, as that time came around, he thought, great, I'm going to get a legendary 993 Turbo, which today would be worth a couple $100,000. But they were all sold by the time the deal finished, and so he was given the brand new 996 with the runny egg headlights. And even though it was, you know, the first water-cooled car, it was a high-demand car, but he was a little bit disappointed in that. And so Not long after he took delivery, he ended up taking the car to a local race shop in Ohio. And they did some kind of experimental things, but most of them were out of either the Porsche catalog or the Porsche Motorsports catalog, designed to make the car as much of a 996.1 GT3 as we could have in the US. Obviously, the first GT3 that really came to the US was the 996.2. And then obviously all the later generations, we've had multiple versions of GT3s and GT3 RSs. So this car was very much inspired by the original GT3. Now that being said, the car spent most of its time at the race shop. That's why it never racked up all that many miles. And the race shop used it for some development projects and some engineering and some problem solving and things like that to, you know, make other products available to other customers. And it became a little bit vague as to exactly how much he was going to owe or if they owed him money for the promotional use and things like that. And around the same time, his relationship with the Penske Auto Group was falling apart because a land deal that was supposed to work out hadn't. So the car was sort of stranded there in this bill ambiguity, not necessarily subject to a mechanics lien, but they weren't just letting him have it, and nobody was talking very well to each other. So at one point, they snuck in and they took the car from the shop. But they didn't want to hide it where either the dealership group or the race shop might come looking for it, so it went to this guy's uncle's house, the brother of the owner, who happened to have a chicken farm. And the car sat outside right next to all the chickens. And so all of the chickens were like walking around in the car and pooping on the car and the paint was being destroyed. And the uncle was supposed to be taking care of the car, but that wasn't necessarily happening. And while the uncle had it, somebody, I guess, either tried to steal the car or maybe did take it away, but it was recovered somehow. Again, none of this was documented on a police report or a Carfax, but the damage that was done to the front bumper, where you would have wanted to brake in order to get access to the trunk and all that, that's when that happened. At some point, the uncle came under the impression that in exchange for his long-term storage of the vehicle, it had become his. And that disagreement between him and his brother sort of resulted in kind of a family feud of sorts. And at one point, the son went in and liberated the car, perhaps with the help of Doug and some of his trucking relationships. And so the car went from there to Doug's storage facility and honestly just sat for a little while. So Doug thought the car was just absolutely fascinating. The idea of making it a running and driving version of itself, but not changing any of the amazing patina that the car had developed over its life, he thought was just the coolest combination ever. And so he had started just a little bit before I'd asked him to go find me a car, helping this guy with some mechanical help and referrals to different shops that could kind of bring the car back to life. So they had done a laundry list of things, including every service, obviously, but also a new clutch, new tires, new things like that, but not done anything to the amazingly terrible appearance of the car. And he was still a little bit on the fence because this guy's kind of got a family, he's got kids and stuff that he's obviously not going to really use the car. Oh, he was thinking about buying something a little bit newer. And so when the idea of me buying the car came up, well, it would kind of add to its crazy story, it being used in a car trek series. And I had said, look, I don't know how much I'm going to love the car. I've had several Porsches over the years. I had the 993, I had the Roof RT12S, I had a 944 Turbo, my wife had a Cayenne S, and honestly, I've just never fallen in love with a Porsche. The Cayenne was obviously as close as I ever came, and so I said, look, I'm probably going to enjoy this car like I have most of the car trek cars, but I have far too many cars at this point, so I'll probably want to sell it at the end, and if you end up just wanting to buy me out of it, I would be fine with that. And so I kind of help him to co-finance some of the repairs that need to be done to make the car mechanically ready, and we sort of start on that mission. And we get the car down here, and honestly, it's doing well. There's a brake issue that we have to sort out once it gets here, but other than that, the car drives absolutely fine. It goes over 150 miles an hour, and I'm having an absolute blast with the car. Honestly, because of how terrible it looks, much more than because it's a Porsche. I mean, I like Porsches as the appliances for speed that they are, but the emotion never really comes in. Now, when you pull up in one that has the paint falling off of it, holes all in it, and scratches and dents and everything like that, that's a story. And I always love a car with a story more than I love a car that's absolutely perfect. And so I took it to Caffeine and Octane, and obviously I took it out to Car Trek. And so we show up in Kansas. This was gonna be kind of a Tyler's Best Hits version of Car Trek. If you looked at Car Trek 5, our journey and our dream cars and our first cars, like that was very much like Ed's greatest hits. I got to drive a McLaren F1, I got to race a fighter jet in a 765, and I got to show off my dream car, my LP640 manual. But that was very much an Ed wins everything, and I had all the fun in the whole wide world. And so doing things in Tyler's backyard, going places that he had sort of been before in some of his cars, and ending up in Colorado sounded like the perfect journey again for Car Trek. And so we get out there, I see the other cars, and we have an absolute blast. We do a dyno shop, we do a drag strip. We were reunited with some of the alumni cars from prior Car Trek seasons. Many of them have been purchased by the Wichita Car YouTube Mafia that you've seen appear here. But it was really, really a ton of fun. I'm not going to spoil any of the outcomes for you, but please check out the series. We're releasing it this week on Freddie's channel. I'll put a link in the description to any episodes that have been released by the time we release this video. But I did really, really come to like the car. I'm not sure I would say that I loved a Porsche in this circumstance, but I had an awful lot of fun. And I will say that the guy decided he had to have it back. And so he wrote me a check just about as soon as I pulled it back into the garage and off the truck here. And so it is back home. It's in much better running condition, and he is having a lot of fun with it until, of course, he had to put it away for the winter because he made the mistake of living somewhere where it gets too cold. But it now has another great story to go with the amazing story it already had. I have to thank Auto Tempest for their support of this month of VINwiki Car Stories and of Car Trek. All the cars one search is Auto Tempest model, and it couldn't be any more true. They compile the listings from all the major listing sites into one place, and it makes it easier than ever and a much more powerful tool than you could possibly imagine to find your next car. We do use it for Car Trek. We search for cars in every possible way, and they just added Facebook Marketplace. They've always let you search Craigslist nationally, which is a huge thing. It's how I originally found Auto Tempest long before I had a YouTube channel or anything like that. But now they let you do that with Facebook Marketplace. You don't have to keep typing different cities and using their 100 or 500 mile search radius. Now you can search the whole country. So check them out right now at the link in the description below to thank them for their support of VINwiki and for sponsoring another season of Car Trek. Have a great day.